They say that modern labor-saving devices leave the housewife with all the time in the world to spare. But most housewives hold down more than one job. And though they still manage to keep up their high standards of homemaking and housekeeping, the shopping often has to be done in the short period between the two halves of their lives. But if, nowadays, the housewife carries the can, it's one that is full of good things. When canned goods were first introduced into this country, they were thought of as great luxuries. Nowadays, they've brought better living into the lives of all of us. Whether they be rare delicacies or run-of-the-mill everyday things like beans, we all know that the contents of the cans are easy to use. The careful checking to ensure that we get our full whack of whatever we buy is typical of the care taken right through the whole chain of preparation. Only the best of the goods available on the market are bought by the people who put them into cans. And they are kept under close hygienic control during all the various operations which are carried out on them. Electronics comes into the picture. They use it to examine the products and to throw out any unwanted bits. It's a much sterner judge than any human could be. Great care is taken with the millions of cans used to ensure that the food they will contain will be kept in perfect condition. The cooking and canning of vast quantities of food calls for a large supply of heat. Here, at the great new Heinz factory, they know that the most economical source of such heat is steam. Steam from Babcock boilers. With a turn of a valve, it can provide the gentle temperatures used in preparing the most delicate of foods, or the high ones needed in the sterilizing plant to ensure prolonged keeping quality for the canned products. Day after day, the endless stream of canned goods flows out to the packing rooms. And thence to the stores and to the shops. It's no exaggeration to say that the economy of steam heating helps to ensure that the housewife gets her full money's worth when she carries the can. In 1959, Killeen Castle, now the property of the Scottish National Trust, became a center of international interest when President Eisenhower stayed there. And because he's a golfer, he was inevitably drawn to Turnberry, 5 miles away along the Ayrshire coast, to the Turnberry Hotel, and to the golf links nearby, where he played the noble game. And on the same links, in October 1959, the contest for the Babcock and Wilcox inter-departmental shield was fought on the Ailsa and Arran courses. The awards went to the two best scores on each course. Players came from many parts of the organization, from office and factory floor alike. In earlier days, John Andrew from Renfrew Foundry, with his knowledge of sand, might have had a bit of an advantage when teeing off. But on the Arran course, he used the ever-popular peg tee. Dr. Miller, works MO, gets a great deal of satisfaction from his everyday job. But there's a lot of satisfaction, too, in that invigorating drive. Hugh McQueen, machine shop superintendent, and Jim McKenzie, boring machine operator, spend much of their working time over the problem of boring holes. But they don't find the 18 holes on the course boring. They trail from one to another for hours and deal with them quite adequately when they find them. What with the diagrid for Hinkley Point and all his other production and administrative problems, works manager Bob Patterson has quite a lot on his plate. But it doesn't seem to cramp his style in the contest. And on the Ailsa course as well, noble work was done. Our camera caught Jim McGuire and Tommy McEwen putting on the second green. Behind them, Alan Gemmell and Joe Gray were only just teeing off for the first hole of the course. And all the while, Ailsa Craig sat out there quietly watching the players trying to deal with the vagaries of the little white ball. Willie Roo, club secretary, soon got down to doing his own bit in the tournament. And the gallant band struggled on, trying to keep down the number of strokes and unfailingly succeeding in adding to them. Mind you, with 80 people to play off, you couldn't afford to waste any time. A player had to be quite punctual. Of course, a nice quiet approach helped matters. No flapping. Everything in its proper place. Correct stance and approach. The proper club. A nice, well-collected drive. See what I mean? John McCall used rather quieter methods to sink a good long un under the critical eye of Alan Law from London. The weather offered no surprises. As the day wore on, the rain came down more and more. But being thoroughly wet outside was a good excuse for carrying on to the 19th hole. Well, it was all very good fun, especially for the engineering department, who won the Lion Shield, here being held by Andrew Thompson. Of course, such an event had to be recorded. Not perhaps a very original pictorial subject, but nevertheless a really worthwhile one. A group of fellow workers who've come together in friendly rivalry and in good fellowship. In less than 2 years, the shores of the Bristol Channel at Hinkley Point in Somerset have been transformed by the construction of an atomic power station by a group of great companies, English Electric, Babcock and Wilcox, and Taylor Woodrow. And in recent months, the Goliath crane, built by Babcock at Renfrew and Dalmuir, has come into its own in assisting this great enterprise. Large enough to straddle the 180-foot-high reactor buildings, the crane can lift any weight up to 400 tons from any part of its working area and set it down with precision at any other part. Here, Goliath is moving a ring section that has been prefabricated on site from plates sent down from Renfrew. Sections made in this way will be welded together to form a 3-inch thick steel sphere, 67 feet in diameter, inside the reactor housing. This great pressure vessel will contain the atomic furnace. Gas heated by the furnace will pass through boilers to generate steam, The steam will be used to drive electric generators that will be housed in a great building, much of which has been cut from the solid rock of Somerset. In the Babcock prefabrication bay, the shell of a steam-raising unit is being built from component rings, also sent down from Renfrew. Because of the size of the vessel, work that would be normally done in the factory is now performed on site by a team of Babcock-trained welders. Before the work is passed, every inch of every weld is x-rayed to check its soundness. Then comes the job of lifting the finished vessel into position. The men in charge know that this will be the great test for Goliath. So does each man taking part in the lift. Even those who are not immediately concerned with the operation share this feeling. They all know that for the first time, the crane will be lifting nearly the maximum working load for which it was designed. Slowly but surely, the Goliath moves its load upwards, all 380 tons of it. At last, the whole weight of the vessel is supported by the great crane. Then the Goliath starts to move the vessel towards its final position. This will be alongside one of the reactors. The journey is slow and cautious. Vigilance must never be relaxed. The first of 12 steam raising units is in position. Goliath has passed its biggest test with flying colors, justifying the confidence of its designers, the men who made it, and those who operated. A giant stride has been taken towards the completion of the Hinkley Point project.